Hey, Quess.
Hey, Mama Bell. We'll get started in just a few minutes, y'all. Y'all just enjoy a little music as we bring y'all in.
No problem. I'm going to be working on dinner.
All right, you do that.
Angela or Quess?
Quess, Nana Anoa was trying to ask you something.
Okay.
No, I'm just trying to say when I sing, I'm not going to have my face showing. Okay?
It's okay.
All right. That's all. Thank you.
It's all good. Thank you. Mm-hmm.
You can do whatever you want with the TV.
Is the person.
Thank you.
Greetings, brothers and sisters and siblings. I trust everybody's doing well. Welcome to Taking Down NOLA's monthly forum. This is In the Spirit of Resistance, Take Them Down and Build Them Up, the Black August edition. So had to kick that thing off, right, and greet y'all in the spirit of revolution. You know, shouts out to Arrested Development for keeping that narrative going all the way through the 90s, but we're taking this all the way back to the 70s from which it comes in the spirit of the Black quote-unquote radical tradition, the revolutionary tradition, which is the very tradition out of which Take 'Em Down NOLA is birthed, that which understands the war that we are inevitably born into as Black, brown, marginalized, and oppressed people under a capitalist system, under a white supremacist system, under a heteropatriarchal system, that we are at any given time singly, doubly, or triply oppressed and marginalized by way of the systems that we are born into. And therefore, we need to be at least singly, doubly, or triply aware and sharpened in our lens and in solidarity with one another as we understand our fight. And so we hope that tonight you can come, as you come here, that you can get some information, some inspiration information in the name of that fight. We have been waging this fight for at least 5 years now as Take 'Em Down NOLA. By the way, my name is Quess, one of the organizers and founders of Take 'Em Down NOLA. We came together back in July of 2015, when we just said enough, no more. And of course, when we said enough, no more, we were saying that in response to the litany of state-sanctioned murders against Black lives, most specifically Mike Brown, and a lack of indictment of Darren Wilson, which led us to get charged and engaged in a fight in the fall of 2014, and finally get solidified into a coalition by 2015. So just tell you a little bit about Take 'Em Down NOLA really quickly. I'm going to give you our mission statement, which defines our purpose. And after that, I'm going to pass it off to some comrades to get us into the actual proceedings this evening. Take 'Em Down NOLA is a Black-led, multiracial, intergenerational coalition of activists, organizers, artists, educators, and working people committed to the removal of all symbols to white so-called supremacy, which we understand to really be an expression of inferiority in New Orleans and the world at large, most specifically here in New Orleans, as a part of the greater push for racial and economic justice. We have a shared interest in grassroots work and education to undo racism and the structures and symbols that uphold systemic oppression. We understand that the removal of statues and symbols is just the first step in addressing the layers of violence and trauma faced historically and presently by the Black community. So just a little history about us. Like I said, we started because of the violence waged against Black lives and bodies, but we understood that we couldn't just keep having a conversation about, no justice, no peace, if we didn't understand the history that gave the context to why we suffered these injustices. And so because of elders, revolutionary scholars like our brother Malcolm Suber, you'll hear from later on tonight, who've been waging this war since the 70s and educating us about the landscape of New Orleans and the 17 monuments that once stood here. Now there's only 10 left because of our work, but the 17 monuments that once stood here, the white inferiority, we understood that you cannot say Black Lives Matter if you live within the context of a city that tells you that our lives don't matter by praising the people that told us that we were less than human. So if you have a statue of a slaver, that stands in the city, in the center of your city, on a 68-foot pillar, 16 feet high itself, and this is the thing that's praised and uplifted, then you can't simultaneously be confused or wonder why it is that our lives are so devalued. So we use that as an entry point to talk about much deeper issues than the symbolism, much deeper issues than the aesthetic and the style of the oppression, but instead the substance of our oppression that comes in the form of the economics and the infrastructure that upholds this unjust system. So to that end, we don't just say take them down, we also say build them up. We're not just out here shooting blindly. We are doing this in the name of restoring to us ourselves and our collective, the humanity that this system has tried to rob from us. So to speak to the other end of the take them down mission, I want to tell y'all a bit about build them up. We say build them up in the name of all the brilliant, resilient history that lives in our DNA, collective conscious, and that is buried beneath the debris of capitalist decay. We say build them up in the name of the 30 plus indigenous tribes that occupied this colonized land for 3,000 years when it wore its original name of Bubansha. We say build them up in the name of the hundreds of thousands of Africans stolen from our native lands to be enslaved here and do free labor at the edge of an oppressor's whip for some 138 years during slavery, to do underpaid labor at the butt of a police officer's gun for some 80 years under Jim Crow, who to this day endure the abuses of capitalistic wage slavery, still at the butt of a police's gun, who defend the agendas of oppressive bosses and manipulative puppet politicians who serve the rich ruling class and not the people. We say build them up in the name of the mostly black children and families and the brown children and families who receive only 3% of the city's budget's funds and only 1% for the job development of their parents, while 63% is doled out to prisons, cops, jails, and reactive measures to lock us up. We say build them up in the name of the black women upon whose back much of the number one tourism industry in the world stands, right here in New Orleans, bringing in nearly $9 billion just last year, while black women in New Orleans suffer the largest pay gap between them and white men in the United States. So in the name of all black, brown, and oppressed workers in New Orleans and our rich ancestry, hearkening back to Senegal, Nigeria, the Congo, Benin, Haiti, the Caribbean, in the name of the 3,000-year-old stewards of this land, the Choctaw, the Chitimacha, the Coushatta, the Atacapa, the Caddo, the Chickasaw, the Houma, the Natchez, the Tunica, and the dozens of indigenous people that modeled humanity on this land for thousands of years before it was invaded by murderous cowards and thieves, we say build them up. We are removing the weeds of white inferiority so that we can fertilize the seeds of our collective liberation. And until that job is done, we say take them down, build them up. So that's what we come together for this evening, y'all. I'm gonna go ahead and pass it off to our sister, Vanna. She is going to pour some libations for us and you know, bring us into the space together. I know we gotta be digital right now because of COVID, but just imagine we all in the same space together in an open, you know, environment where we'd be sharing our energy and our shape amongst each other. This is what Vanna does for us. So y'all give it up, hand claps, golf claps, what have you, show us some love. Some friction for our sister bottom.
Peace, y'all. I'm burning a little sage over here, cleaning the atmosphere. Y'all feel free if you have some. Send the energy your way. Everybody take a deep breath real quick. I know today's been busy. We all got a thousand things to do, have done, are doing. So let's just slow it down right now. We're gonna do a libation, but let's just take a deep breath. So I'm gonna ask at a point here soon for us to call out the names of some revolutionary freedom fighting ancestors. We are calling only at this time those who have passed beyond the veil. We are only calling the names of those who have transitioned to charge the atmosphere, to ask that this space and time not be in vain, but be a part of an ongoing, ever-growing, politically grounding, soul-stretching spirit of resistance, one that swells and is persistent from each of our internal landscapes to the spheres we inhabit physically. So in the spirit of Sankofa, going back to the root for strength, we recall those who have passed through the veil from life to death, to earth to breath. Remember those who resisted to gift us with life. Ubuntu. I am because we are. We remember the daughters of the maroon societies whose struggle defies gravity and define liberation. Hail to those we knew and loved. Their bodies give us strength today. Reverence to those whose names we don't remember, but whose memories we carry in our bones and souls and DNA composition breathe as we remember. Exhaling toxic energy, releasing that which does not serve the greater good of the liberation of all people, breathe into liberation. Breathe into clarity. Together we can cultivate our collective healing. From the sacred center of our being, we can imagine, we can breathe together collectively. We're gonna take 5 deep breaths together. And I'm gonna ask maybe 6 people, let's do 7 people, to unmute your mic. And we're gonna say the names of revolutionary freedom fighter ancestors. And we're gonna pour libation. I'm gonna start with Queen Nanny of the Maroon Society.
Ashe. Claudia Jones.
Ashe. Walter Rodney.
I'll say Ida B. Wells.
Fannie Lou Hamer and Loretta Castle Haley. Ashe.
That put us at 5. Who's got 2 more?
John Brown.
George Jackson.
Ashe, and I'm gonna throw Fred Hampton in there as well. Layla's whispering Michael Jackson in my ear. Ashe. Peace, y'all.
Asheo, appreciate you, Modupeo. Thank you, Sister Vanna, for that. Thank you, Layla, for that insightful offering, because they all I want to say is they don't really care about us, right? That's part of that, too. A couple of housekeeping things I didn't really address. Thank you, most of y'all, for catching that in the chat. We are asking that everybody keeps their video on, at least for the first portion of this presentation. Just so we know who you are, you know, we don't just do showcases for the sake of it. We are organizers first, even though we're gonna get real artsy tonight. And so security is a thing, but also the fact that we want to be able to build with folks. And I see a lot of folks who have been building with us. So shouts out to you. If you've been out here in these streets with us, we're gonna be there on Saturday. We'll talk about that more later. Shouts out to you if you've been coming to political classes, I see y'all. If you've been working security with us out in the streets, I see y'all. If you've been, coming to workers group events, if you've been doing your own organizing, trying to get the names of racists off of schools, I see y'all. And y'all are going to be out here on Saturday with us. So thank y'all for coming through. I also want to address before we transition to the drumming. We are here in the spirit of Black August. I'm not going to get too deep into that because our featured speaker this evening, our brother Jitu, is one of the founders of Black August, and he's going to tell us about it. But Black August, in short, is born out of the tradition of radical resistance, Black radical resistance, most specifically connected to our ancestor George Jackson, who was an activist and organizer within the prison, San Quentin, I believe, where he was murdered by the state only a year after his brother was murdered by the state in an attempt to release him. And so in the spirit of, you know, that radical, field Negro type resistance that knows that there's no negotiating mm-hmm. with white supremacy, there's no negotiating with the state, that this is a war that's waged on us, that we have to be militant in order to be victorious in and win. We don't just celebrate Black August, but we commemorate it by continuing on in that militant tradition. So it's the spreading of information, that's what gets us excited. The sharing of revolutionary theory, that's what gets us excited. And much of the practice of Black August is that discipline. Fasting is involved, study is involved, and you know, this is a bit of what we're doing tonight. So thank y'all for joining us in that. I'm gonna go ahead and pass it off to our next presenter for the evening, our brother Corey Williams. He's gonna give us some drums. So y'all give some get a drummer sound real quick. Get a drummer sound.
Peace, what's up? Can y'all hear me? Cool. We just gonna get it started.
When you put on this record, understand, this is for all of my ancestors who were raped, who were killed, and hung because of their plight for freedom and for dignity. They died for me, and they died for you. This is for them to know that, yes, even today, in 1992, we are still fired up, and we're still talking about revolution.
Yeah.
Record.
All right, y'all. Y'all continue to get the drummer some on that one. Y'all got to hear Revolution twice tonight, so it's already a good night. And I know it sounded a whole lot better just now with them drums on it. So we're gonna pass it off from there. Straight from we keeping it real African tonight. We went from the libations to the drums, so now we're gonna have some song coming from our Mama Nana is gonna go ahead and bless us with some of that this evening. Nana Anoa, you have the floor, go ahead.
Thank you. Thanks, Quess. Thanks for the invitation. Yeah, I know several of the faces too, and I really feel I just feel so good about being able to make an offering. And I was thinking of something and I didn't have to think at all because it came to me. So I want to sing in honor of the great mother, Fannie Lou Hamer. That's the energy that so showed up for me. It certainly is timely in terms of a lot of things. Just the things you talked about, building them up, resistance and resilience. You said something that just now, no, she was very clear that there was no negotiating with white supremacy. So I'll make my best effort to make this happen because I've not done it over Zoom. And if it doesn't come out right, it ain't because I ain't giving it my best, okay? All right, so I'm sure everybody on this call knows about Sister Fannie Lou Hamer. One of the things that moved me most was when she talked about the beating she took in 1961, I think it was, in Winona. And yeah, I'm sure you can Google it if you're not aware. But I make this to someone else who was there as well, whose name was not said by her. But I believe when I listened to that talk, she was one of those women who even fortified Sister Fannie Lou Hamer's courage. So, Fannie Lou Hamer, Fannie Lou Hamer, Fannie Lou Hamer, Fannie Lou Hamer. This little light of mine, her song would fill the air. She rocked the state of Mississippi. Now a whole lot more black people stand there. Fannie Lou Hamer. Fannie Lou Hamer. Fannie Lou Hamer. Ooh, Fannie Lou Hamer. For 20 years when she weighed the cotton down on a white man's farm. She received threats on her life, was fired from her job, scorned and kicked off the farm. Fannie Lou Hamer, you can say her name, Fannie Lou Hamer. Fannie Lou Hamer. Fannie Lou Hamer. She said, we're sick and tired of being sick and tired. That's what the lady would yell. Her body was beaten and she walked crippled. For trying to vote, she was thrown in jail. Fannie Lou Hamer. Fannie Lou Hamer. Feel it, y'all. Fannie Lou Hamer. Fannie Lou Hamer. Land of the free and home of the slave. She criticized the law of the land. For 100 years, blacks lived in fear, but now they marched and they took their lives in their hands. Fannie Lou Hamer. Fannie Lou Hamer. Fannie Lou Hamer, be inspired by Fannie Lou Hamer. She passed by here just short of 60 years, and she didn't stay long. She tried to turn a few things around. Cancer took her body, yet we and the struggle got her soul. When they laid her body in the ground, Fannie Lou, Fannie Lou Hamer, Fannie Lou Hamer, all praises to Fannie Lou Hamer. Ashe, 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 thank you.
Ashe, yeah. Yo. Modupeo, thank you, Mama. Nana Anoa. Thank you. Yeah. I so missed the space we could share. We could really, really feel it. But to say that, you know, we over digital, I almost feel like I'm sitting next to you. Like that was close right there. I see some of y'all was rocking, like y'all in, you know what I'm saying, Revolutionary Church. I see Corey's over there trying to get the drums going. Yeah, you got us. You got us. Thank you for the energy. So we gonna go from there to some words, some verbiage from my brother, my fellow scribe, big brother. Y'all probably know him from Cafe Istanbul back when we used to actually go there back in the day. And one day there's going to be a day. We're going to be back up in there sharing this live in the flesh. He liked to get his thing on too. I ain't, you know, making no requests or nothing, but if you want to, you know, bust a little tune, we are always open to the genius of our brother Chuck Perkins. Give some friction.
Thank you, my brother. Nah, I just want to say I'm a big fan of Fannie Lou Hamer as well. And, you know, being organizers and being a part of a political organization, I think one of the things we learned from her is that typically when people think about, you know, what we are doing here, they think of younger people, right? But Fannie Lou Hamer was from the Mississippi Delta and she was older. She got started older in the game, but she was fierce. She wasn't compromising, and she contributed a great deal to the struggle. And but she got started late, so there's still time for all of us, for our aunts, our grandmothers, everybody. I think that's one thing we can learn from her. And so anyway, I won't hold you. I got a few words, and then I'm gonna get out of here. My son, even if they rip you out of my arms, even if they drag me from the sight of your scared, precious eyes kicking and screaming, even if you can no longer see my scarred body and troubled mind, even if you are beyond earshot of my emasculated pleas of mercy that burns into embers of curses and condemnation, even if you never know that my most vivid dreams in a world without your baby scent are sepia tone and flat, and how every day I stand one breath away from suffocating in a cauldron of anguish over you. Even if you can never understand my conundrum of wanting to be a good father in these heavy chains, and that my thin skin and callous hands are no armor against their big bullets that can pulverize my bones. You should know that this hell is temporal and earthly, and that our spirits lay claim to the blessed realm of the ancestors. I will always love you, and we will never be alone, regardless how many oceans they wedge between us. We will never be without each other. I raised both hands, and you didn't shoot me. You aim your gun at an apparition, a monster constructed in your head, a gift to you by the sins of your father. This brute won't leave. He howls in your head every time you see me. This was not about today. Your hate is too big to be frivolous. You shot to slay the monster. He's the criminal. Your ghost looks like me, but I'm just a man, flesh and bones. My blood flows like the river. But you didn't shoot me. If today were the day, if swans folded the sky like war-proud veterans folding a flag, if stars gathered in a circle, giving the planet a striking resemblance to Saturn, if clouds ascended from Earth to beyond the planets in the formation of a grand stairwell, and if the answer to the question descended those clouds one stair at a time, and you turn with your vision blurred by a time when miracles were small and insignificant to see what hadn't been seen in 2,000 years, child of the star maker, magician of the resurrection, object of the prophecy. Where you gonna be? How you gonna act? Will you crack your closet and your I love you, but you gotta go voice and beg your sins to quietly leave? Would you wag your finger and shout to the top of your lungs, I told you so, in a conspicuous attempt to convince your maker that you had never doubted? Would the salty waters of confirmation find rivers on your face? Would the preachers on fire, early Sunday morning shouts of hallelujah and have mercy, find life beneath your tongue? And have mercy, and find mercy between your hands, beneath your feet and on your tongue? Would you drop your knees and beg for deliverance? Would you embarrass the child of the star maker by wanting to kiss his feet? Where you gonna be and how you gonna act? If the wind blew a song but faith remained blind, if the child of the star maker appeared at your door, skin painted dark by a million strokes of the sun, hair that eats the teeth of fragile combs, where you gonna be and how you gonna act? With the salty waters of fear, find raindrops on your brow, causing words to shake out of your mouth. Would you be unable to believe the miracle at the door because its lips are too big? Would your vision become scrambled in the prism of your narrow head, forcing you to see the butt of ill repute while looking into the eyes of the star maker's child? Where you gonna be and how you gonna act? Would you crack your closet and drink spirits on the dark side of your heart, swallowing plantation-style dogmas that cause its teeth and fingers to sharpen? Maybe not. But if the child of the star maker appeared at your door, skin painted dark by a million strokes of the sun, tired and hungry, would you give him a piece of your oyster po' boy? Thanks a lot, y'all. I'm out.
I appreciate you, big brother. Thank you, Chuck, for putting us in the spirit of some inspiration information with some of that scripting. That sounds like some new, too. I haven't heard that one before. So, yeah, thank you for the new stuff, man. All right, y'all. So we're about to get into the actual presentations this evening. But once upon a time, before organizing took 80% of most of my days, I used to get a little poetry in and on every once in a while. So I'm gonna drop some bars for y'all if that's okay. If y'all could just give me a little friction for the spitting that's about to come your way. Coming to the stage next is none other than yours truly. I'm gonna give y'all a quick little medley that will hopefully perfectly segue into what we're about to talk about in a second. Knowing that I walk atop the bones of my ancestors, in the shadow of their oppressors, towering statuesque above me, I cannot look down without feeling the puzzled pieces of my past beckoning me back together, cannot look up without feeling the weight of history break me into pieces. I cannot leave this ground and feel whole, cannot stand it either without its heavy sky pummeling my dreams into nightmares. The ground is a haunt, is a restless cauldron of simmering spirits bubbling over beneath the souls of callous sojourners, singed by the heat beneath their feet, yet numb to the stories in its ferment. The sky is riddled in dead eyes, the probing gaze of ghastly men, now ghosts cast into iron, who in flesh owned men, women, and children, my kin, who in flesh beat men, women, and children, my kin, who in flesh raped men, women, and children, my kin, who in flesh slaughtered, maimed, murdered men, women, and children that look just like me. I cannot leave this ground where the scattered bones of my ancestry lay namelessly, without tomb nor headstone, sans burial ground, much less monument, and not feel the echoes of a chorus of gnashing teeth, testimonies hissing at my heels. Cannot stand this ground. There once slavers hovering above us, without feeling the frozen laughter of gilded antebellum, the sky, a glacier of silence, but it speaks so loudly. If you dare to listen close, you'll hear their names, whispering proclamations of self-praise from the perch of street signs that hang like still nooses suspended in time, lynching the esteem of listless passers-by, the stories beneath their feet and above their heads having passed them by, yet the themes having ground their weight into their subconscious, making of their minds infertile soil, insufficient to nourish the seeds of dreams, for the dead eyes have probed and made lifeless the soil. The bones have spoken, but their voices have been muted by the cast iron gaze above. I live in New Orleans, where the bones of my ancestors beat the ground like a drum, bang bambula rhythms through the souls that walk this land. I live in the South, where monuments to Robert E. Lee, P.G.T. Beauregard, and Jefferson Davis once stood taller than most homes, and the street signs, they are still noosed in the names of slavers. I cannot leave this ground and feel whole, cannot stand it either, and not feel history trying to break me on its cyclic wheel. Cause see, I was touring the Texas state capitol. My small brown body cast against the canvas of tall white coliseums and things was reaching back centuries. It was dwarfing in the bleached shadows of their history. With brown bodies like mine, were but minor details in the portrait of American destiny manifest only in the margins as footnotes on the pages of recorded history. But right now, my thoughts are of Brianna. Brianna of light Latina hue and American college girl humor, she is a walking library of white supremacist mythology trapped in a mausoleum of mestizo skin. Brianna, knowledgeable tour guide who just walked me and some 30 visitors through the pristine halls of the state capitol. The jokes, they glint off of her tongue with irony. Her commentary, it clashes with her culture as she speaks of Texas history in a possessive. We were defeated in the Battle of the Alamo in 1836, she says. We rallied back 6 weeks later and won the Battle of San Jacinto, thereby founding the great state of Texas, she continues. And I keep trying to figure out how she manages to fit all her light brown me Inside of all that Western white we, how she can so easily mince memories of moccasin shoe mamas beneath the still toes and stairs of Lone Star boots now walking across the marble floors of her oppressive history as she speaks. There's a festival going on in the right, there's a festival going on outside of the Capitol. Her voice struggles to be heard above the booming bass lines of reggae tone rhythms blaring from the speakers outside. And I can't help but wonder if the cognitive dissonance inside her head doesn't blare just as loudly. There are women, many of them are Breonna's hue, dancing to her people's music. I think they're doing Zumba or the Macarena or something that English words fail to do justice. I'm just struggling to see how she fails to see the injustice in the story she's been paid to propagate. And can she hear her ancestors' rebuttal thumping through the drums as they echo through the halls of the Texas State Capitol? Breonna, can you hear your ancestors calling? At the end of the tour, an elderly white woman asked Breonna, what does the word Texas mean? And she quickly replies, it's a Caddo Indian word for friendship. And I immediately want to look up the word friendship and see if there's anything I missed. Perhaps there are etymological references to blood-splattered chieftains and trails of tears. Maybe these are key ingredients to lifelong bonds and I'm the oblivious one. Or maybe Texas, like Louisiana, like America, like all of the Western wide world, is just a really fucked up friend. The kind of advice grips your bones and its handshake until your bones are ground to dust and the remains are left to mix with the blood and sweat of capital gains up on the watered down colors that they use to paint the monuments to their greatness. They'll shade you into their shadows, etch your name into the edges of their borders as footnotes, loser of the battle, vanquished full-term mascot, misguided tour guide through the halls of another man's history, never his foundation, his keeper of this land before hostile takeover, his blood rights to this ground before oil rate Texas. If you are friendship, then what do I call my enemies? And that's that piece, y'all. We're going to move on from that to hear very directly from the source of one of the keepers of this land. As I said in the piece, we're honored to have her voice present, though her body could not be, due to obligations and COVID and what have you. But nonetheless, we've got my sister from the Native Indigenous group, I believe the Homa, out here in Louisiana, not too far.
Choctaw.
Say it again?
Choctaw.
That's right, Choctaw. My bad. I'm looking right at the thing. Say Choctaw. From the Choctaw group, I mentioned the over 30 Indigenous groups that occupied this space for 3,000 years before colonizers ever showed up. And this space was called Bubancha. And amongst the many groups, one of them was the Choctaw. And we have a representative of the Choctaw in the form of our sister Sierra, who's going to speak her words tonight. You'll get to hear those words again Saturday if you come out. And you know, I'm feeling extra honored to get to hear it from the source tonight. So this is our sister Sierra, and Vanna is going to go ahead and present her words. Go ahead, take it away, Vanna.
How you doing? Salvajiva Ud Sierra Lagarde, Mikja Chatabi La Convencia. Hello, everyone. My name is Sierra Lagarde, and I'm a member of the Bayou Lacombe Band of Choctaw, located in Lacombe, Louisiana. I'd like to begin by saying Yoko Kachiro. Thank you very much to Angela and to the other members of Take 'em Down NOLA for giving me this opportunity to speak today. And thank you to all of you in the crowd who are here today in solidarity in our fight to decolonize history. New Orleans, 300. Bubancha, 3,000. Let that sink in. As we stand here today, let us recognize this land acknowledgement, where everywhere you step in this city, every bayou you see, and every beautiful view you admire is all on Native land. May we remember the Achapatula, the Chawasha, the Oklapisa, the Bayou Kokla, the ancient Atapacti, the Chata, and many other tribes of peoples who lived here before, not in New Orleans, but in a city in which my tribe call Bubancha, the land of many tongues. We are here today because we are tired of being surrounded by false narratives, where everywhere we look in this city, we see these monumental statues dedicated to these so-called monumental men, like Andrew Jackson and like Jean-Baptiste Bienville. These men were never great. Okay, they were never great, but rather are the very illusion of greatness, because all of their so-called achievements were done through the systematic exploitation and suffering of Native and Black peoples. When I look at the Bienville statue, I see a false representation of a Chitimacha man sitting defeated next to a tall standing Jean-Baptiste Bienville. But Bienville never founded New Orleans in 1718. Why? Because it was an already established city inhabited by many of our indigenous communities. But that's not written in history books, now is it? When I see the Jackson Monument, I see him sitting victoriously on his horse, relishing in his new title of Savior of the Crescent City, when in fact, he would have never won without the help of the enslaved and Choctaw people. Well, you know what? I say no more. If there is anyone in this country who knows what our Black brothers and sisters are going through, it's us. We are perpetually linked by the systematic oppression and racism that have bound us together since the founding of this country. They were taken from their land, and we had our land taken from us. But make no mistake, we Indigenous and Black peoples are not defeated. We are the true victors of their oppression because we are still here. And guess what? We are not going anywhere. We survived here in Bobancha and across Indian country, and we will dismantle the legacies of these white suppressors. Andrew Jackson's hero of the Mississippi and Bienville's founder of New Orleans, and show that we as Indigenous people stand with our Black brothers and sisters, our oldest allies, in both our fights for equality and justice. Now, before I go, I would like to share with you a few days ago what I dreamed. That I was standing at the base of the Bienville Monument, and as I looked up, I saw that the statue had actually been removed. That all of this that was left was a blank pedestal. That all that was left was a blank pedestal. An opportunity for a truth telling of history. And to my surprise, that same morning, Angela actually contacted me and asked me to record this message. This gives me the feeling that something powerful is about to happen, and that this is a legacy that I am happy to say we are all a part of.
I see.
Okichiro, thank you very much, and stay safe, everyone.
All right. I say all of that. That is beautiful. Again, taking us full circle, everything we talked about in terms of take them down, it's about clearing the landscape so this can come back up. There's something powerful about just acknowledging the fact indigenous folks here never went nowhere, never left nowhere. They try to give them new names, they try to reframe them, what have you, but they right here. They right here in my cheekbones. They right here in our DNA. They right here in, especially in New Orleans folks' DNA. And, you know, through Sierra, and the Choctaw folks out there, you know, folks in home and all of the different scattered tribes of Bubancha land, they still exist right here in this city. And as all of this white supremacist capitalist decay is cleared away, all we're going to do is come back up. And so, yeah, one time for that. That's a beautiful, beautiful vision she just shared. One of our elders, Reverend Marie Galatis, who we talk about in the first Taking Down Nola's Name, we interviewed her. She was similar to Sierra. And so much as in the 70s or the 80s or whatever it was, she used to have dreams of all of the monuments coming down, all up and down the East Coast. And so, again, one time for the powerful prophetic vision that ancestors birthed to us and through us that we are given so that we can manifest and bring to life in real time. We are living out the dreams of our ancestors, and we are dreaming the realities that we're going to bring into fruition and that our offspring is going to bring into fruition in the years to come in this struggle. So, in the spirit of elders and the traditions they passed on to us, we are about to hear from our keynote for this evening. I'm going to go ahead and y'all bear with me for 2 seconds as I cue up his bio. I keep doing that. You can tell I live in New Orleans. The brother Jitu Sadiki is one of the founders of Black August. He's going to tell us more Black August, but he is a formerly incarcerated brother who spent a total of 9 years, four of those in solitary confinement, resulted from his political commitment to spread the ideology of Comrade George Jackson and the Black Liberation Movement, among other prisoners in Chino, San Quentin, Soledad, Tehachapi, and Vacaville prisons. He's one of the organizers of the first Black August resistance commemorations in 1979, while he was housed in Soledad's infamous O-Wing. He was a keynote speaker at Malcolm X event at UC Berkeley, is a member of the Black August Organizing Committee 2 weeks after his release in 1982. He's a member of the Equal Rights Congress, a watchdog group for immigrants' rights and victims of police abuse. He joined them after the vicious murder of his brother, who was shot 7 times in the back, just after talking to a group of youth about the pigs holding our communities under siege in October of 1985. He's done all kind of work. Too many bullet points for me to list right here. I want him to go ahead and speak to it himself so y'all can hear from the source. But revolutionary organizer, we are very grateful to have it. I missed this evening. Y'all go ahead and give up some of the heat and the friction for our brother, Jitu Sadiki. The floor is yours.
Thank you, Quess. I'd like to say that I'm really honored to be part of this forum. I'm learning a lot about Take 'Em Down Nolan, and particularly building them up. I like that concept. When we take away something, we want to instill something that's productive, that's positive, and that builds us as a people, as a collective people. I'm currently a representative of Black August Los Angeles, which is based in, of course, Los Angeles. I've been working with them since 2006. It's a group of brothers and sisters who got together to continue that tradition that we started in prison. I want to give a little background on the history or the origin of Black August, what led to the commemoration. And I also want to indicate that this is not a celebration. It's not something that we say happy Black August. This is about those that paid the ultimate price and their fight within the belly of the beast to address issues of injustice and lost their lives, as well as those that continue to remain behind enemy lines as a result of them standing up while in prison and taking that position that they were going to fight against the system wherever they were, whether it was in the belly of the beast or in the case where we had opportunity to come home to continue that fight to liberate our people. This tradition goes back quite some time, and it started as a result of initially in the 60s, mid-60s, brothers coming together, mainly brothers from Islamic faith, and challenging the abuses that existed within the belly of the beast, the lack of opportunities for African prisoners, and came under attack as a result of that. One of the things, this also led to a situation where, particularly in Soledad prison, you got 4 major prisons in California. You got over 30 prisons there, but 4 major prisons, that's San Quentin, Folsom, Soledad, and Tracy, where a lot of activity took place. In Soledad, at that particular time, this is in the early 70s, or actually late 69, early 70s, where there was, the only time that you can come out your cell, you would have to go on the tier and exercise on the tier. And they would do it by race. So there were times when whites would come out and mysteriously a brother's door was unlocked and either he had to come out of his cell and deal with that or they were coming in to deal with him. And a few brothers were murdered that way while the guard turned the other way. They would have the length of the cell is about a 3/4 of a block long, and the width is about 10 to 15 feet. And so a couple of times brothers came out who were targets, and they were able to get the best of those that were attacking them. One of them was a brother by the name of W.L. Nolan. The prison administration decided to integrate a yard where they would allow all of them to go out to the yard, and you had a basketball court there. You had a larger cage where you could exercise and get more movement. And so they taunted a lot of the brothers to make them, to encourage them to go to the yard, and everybody knew that something was gonna jump off. So January 13th, 1970, as they began to integrate the yard, when you come out your cell, you go into a little sally port, they strip search you, and then they check you for weapons and so forth, and then you go down some stairs into the yard, depending on what floor you're coming from. I spent 2 years in that particular unit, O-Wing, before being transferred to another solitary confinement. So I know that intimately. So as they were letting them go out to the yard, they were supposed to do by race, one white, black, and Latino. They would actually let several whites out first, maybe a Latino, then a black. So that by the time that the blacks got on the yard, the Africans got on the yard, they were outnumbered. And approximately, I believe about 10 to 15 people had made it to the yard when a fight broke out and W.L. Nolan was targeted. And when the fight broke out, the gun tower guard shot W.L. And when he shot him, he went down, and two other brothers, Alvin Miller and Cleveland Edwards, ran over to assist W.L. On that particular yard, on the side they were on, there's a hospital on that side. And there's a gate that leads from the exercise yard directly into the hospital. So when the two brothers ran over to get him, what their intent was to take him over by the gate so that they can get him and offer him some medical assistance. They actually were shot also. So you had three individuals laying out on the yard, and then the guards had to clear the yard before they would go out there to get him. Once they cleared the yard, instead of taking them directly into the hospital, they brought them back inside the institution, into the unit, through the unit, out to the corridor, down the hall, and into the hospital. And they died in the process. There was a grand jury that was assembled to determine whether or not the shooting was in policy. Of course, they said it was in policy. And the guard was in charge of the murder of those three individuals. Approximately a week after that, a guard was murdered. And George Jackson, Fleeta Drumgo, and John Clichette was charged with the killing of that guard. They eventually had their case transferred from Salinas County, where this happened, to Marin County, which is near San Quentin prison. And they were going to go on trial for the murder of the guard in San Quentin. During that time, George Jackson, who was pretty prolific in writing, challenging the system, educating brothers politically, educating brothers and helping them understand conditions that we existed in, was also a target. And his younger brother, Jonathan Jackson, who was 17 years old at the time, decided that he wanted to help liberate his brother from prison. He entered into a courtroom in Marin County August 7th, 1970. And there were three brothers in the courtroom, James McClain and William Christmas, who were on trial for an incident involving an assault on a guard in San Quentin. With them was Rochelle McGee, who was a witness to what took place. Jonathan entered the courtroom fully armed, took over the courtroom, armed the other brothers that were in there. They took the judge and the district attorney and two jurors hostage. And his objective was to make it to a radio station so that they could let the public know what was going on and to hold these individuals hostage until their brothers, his brother and the other brothers who became known as Solidarity 3 were released. They made it to the parking lot of the Marin County Courthouse and made it to the van that was waiting out there. And then the San Quentin guards and local police opened fire on the van, killing Jonathan Jackson, William Christmas, James McClain, and the judge. and injuring the district attorney, Rochelle McGee. Rochelle McGee was the only survivor of those that took over that court. And he is still, and I'll talk a little bit more about Rochelle a little later, but he's still in prison as a result of that incident and his original offense. A year later, George Jackson was set up, and he was allegedly supposed to have a gun and was trying to break out the Adjustment Center when he was murdered. And when he was murdered, there was also some other activity that took place in the area where the prisoners took over the Adjustment Center, and three guards and two racist white prisoners were murdered. There were six brothers, there were actually more, it was 26 charged, but eventually six brothers, black and brown, were charged with those crimes. That was Fleeta Drumgo, who was also one of the original Soledad Three, Willie Tate, who we refer to as Sundiata, David Johnson, referred to as Giap, Yogi Pinedo, a Nicaraguan brother, Hugo Pinedo, we refer to him as Yogi, Bato, Luis Talamantes, who is a Latino brother, and Johnny Spain. They all went on trial. Most of them were exonerated of the case, with the exception of Hugo Pinedo. Hugo Pinedo ended up spending 51 years in prison, 46 of those years in solitary confinement, and all prisoners came together as a prisoner class in 2011 and organized a hunger strike as a result of being warehoused in Soledad, San Quentin shoe program for decades. Most of the brothers that went with me, they ended up in solitary confinement when I went in the mid 70s, were still in solitary confinement. And so as a result of that, a class action lawsuit was filed. These brothers were successful with the lawsuit. They also started this thing, agreement to end hostility among prisoners. And most of them came out of the prison, out of the SHU program from 2014 to 2015. Hugo also, for the first time after 46 years, made it out of solitary confinement, was in general population for about 2 weeks before he was set up by the guards and some racist prisoners, racist white prisoners. He was murdered at the age of 71. So fast forward to 1978, we began to talk about in different prisons, primarily in San Quentin, about commemorating those that had lost their lives, those that paid the ultimate sacrifice. One of the orchestrators of the architects of what became known as Black August was a brother by the name of Jeffrey Katari Garland. And Jeffrey, in 1978, August 1st of 1978, sustained an injury and didn't receive any medical assistance, and he died. So beginning in 1979, the time I was in Soledad prison, and I always keep these pictures behind me, kind of in front of me, in terms of my commitment. This is San Quentin prison. This is Soledad. This is the yard that W. Other won when they were murdered. And so we started the practice of commemorating these individuals that lost their lives during the time period. Rochelle, as I indicated, still in prison. He's been in prison for 57 years, going 58. He goes to board next year in the spirit. He's now 81 years old. And if any of y'all know Angela Davis, she was the co-defendant in that case. And her case was severed and she was liberated and he remains in prison. I'd like to read a quote real quickly. This is a letter that I received from Rochelle May 12th of this year. And he states, everybody's saying who met the facts of my situation know what I did August 7, 1970. Any slave we have done in fight against death trap conditions. And at the time that he was in court, he had also been trying to get his original case of kidnapping before the courts because he was railroaded when he first went to prison in 1963. Also, Rochelle spent some time in Angola. He's originally from Louisiana, and he spent some time in Angola prison as a young man in his teens. And shortly after he got out of Angola, his family moved him to California to get away from it, from the racist conditions in Louisiana. And he had only been in California, Los Angeles, for 6 months before this other incident happened that sent him to prison. And he's still fighting for his liberation from that. That kind of covers the history of the resistance inside. There's a lot more detailed information, and I spoken with Angela earlier today, and I was sharing with her that because the we only get sound bites or little information when we're on these type of forums, that I gave up additional information that people can go to Black August Los Angeles website. We've done quite a few Zoom live meetings where we dealt with issues like Black and Brown solidarity. We do a martyrs tour. We've been doing that for about 8 years, where we go to various sites of resistance where brothers, particularly the Panthers, fought. Some of them died, some of them survived it because they fought back. So you can go to our Facebook page. Those are archived. You can see some of those. The shootout with the Panthers and the police on 41st and Central, where Geronimo Jijaga Pratt, who's risen from Louisiana as well, helped to organize those brothers and sisters, and they fought the pigs and survived it. So there's other information. And the other thing I want to speak to is this issue of, I mean, you guys seem like y'all really organized, but there's been history of strife among us. A lot of it was manipulated and initiated by COINTELPRO, counterintelligence program of the FBI. So we talk about those issues, the things that divide us, and those things that we can do to work toward unity. So we've developed a code of conduct. I've shared that information. We also had to address issues among us. And so when we do that among us. We don't involve the pigs. We don't involve the state. If there's an issue among us, we address that. So there are those that have misused their position within the community. And the one thing that we did 6 years ago with the organization that referred to themselves as the Black Riders, and they were a new formation of young people that grew in the spirit of the Black Panther Party, and the leadership was abusing those young people. And so we had to take them to task. And it was a methodical process that led to a successful outcome, where this individual had to be held accountable for those incidents of abuse of not just the people, but the community as well. And the only thing that we could do is bring those issues up, but it depends on the community to enforce that. So he's been ostracized in the community, although we've also used restorative justice to give him opportunity to rectify those issues. But he hasn't been seen in the community in those 6 years, except for once or twice, real discreetly. And there were attempts to indicate that those that addressed that issue were agents working for COINTELPRO or working for the state. None of that worked. Everybody that was involved was reputable, and we have sustained that. And that's one kind of things that we need to do to maintain our unity, not just locally, but nationally as well. I look forward to the opportunity to continue this relationship. I really am impressed with what y'all are doing, and I want to be part of that, or we want to be part of that. There are a couple of books I wanted to make reference to, Prison Letters and Blood in My Eye by George Jackson, another one that deals with a lot of the history of what happens in California prison is Melancholy History of Soledad Prison. So with that, I'm rushing through to make sure that I'm within my time frame, because I know y'all have a lot to cover, but I'll be on the program until the end. If there's any questions, I'll be happy to entertain those questions. Free to land.
Brother Jitu, we want to say thank you so much for making the time and putting forth the energy to be with us. We could not be more grateful that you've carved out time to share with us just your experience. We could not be more honored. We've spent so much time engaging as it relates to just trying to understand and apply the learnings from Black August, and to have you in the midst of us is quite an honor. And so we look forward to continuing to build from today and continuing to learn from you. And again, we're very, very grateful. So thank you again for being with us here today.
It's my honor.
Yeah, thank you, Brother Jitu, not just for dropping the history, but even giving us some strategy, even right on site, you know what I mean? Some of what you're talking about in terms of how to deal with those kind of issues in the community. I mean, these are like more than just like us presenting stuff, and this is for everybody listening as well. But this is semi-organizing on the spot as well, you know what I mean? And that restorative justice piece and on how to deal with, you know, issues and transgressions in the community, that's like, that's key. And that's coming up all the time, especially in a hot time like now, where all kind of stuff is in the fan. We always at war, but we got to be able to keep our troops healthy and in solidarity at the same time too. So thank you for that. I'm sure other folks got comments, questions, reflections. I posted in the chats earlier. Please hold those to the end. We are actually making good time. We have one more presenter tonight. We're going to let him do his thing, and then we're going to take about 15 minutes to let y'all chime in with, you know, whatever questions or reflections you have. But yeah, we're going to go ahead and segue from one highly esteemed great elder to another. This is from a guy, our in-house elder, without whom none of us would be doing this work. I don't think I need to give that much of an introduction to Malcolm, but we know that, you know, he's been doing this since 1978 or so, when he first came to New Orleans, in terms of all of the grassroots organizing, from, you know, marching for Black Lives before it had that name, you know, working against police terror, working against the white supremacist capitalist state, as a true blue, you know, grassroots revolutionary, was sent here on a mission 42 years ago to get things popping. And he has not fallen off that mission to this day. And because of that, we can have thousands of people in the street at a time like this, because we're absorbing a lot of his knowledge and his wisdom, and we're taking that and implementing it and spreading it to y'all. When y'all get political study classes, y'all get, you know, us in the street every Saturday, all of that. These are things that elders like Malcolm modeled for us, but most particularly him. He's gonna talk to us tonight in terms of the Take Him Down struggle about moving from Andrew Jackson Square, which I hate to even say that out loud, it gives me the heebie-jeebies to say that, to Juan San Malo Square. We are very much in the building up spirit at this point. We are claiming a victory in the name of the Egungun and the ancestors and our revolutionaries that still live and came before us. And we feel like we won already. You feel me? I don't know how, I mean, I know it looked bad out there. I know it's nasty out there. But when it's that nasty, it's because they're that scared and they're that damn weak. We're ready to push them off the edge. And as we push them off the edge, everything that's been here for hundreds of thousands of years, before any white supremacist, as my boy E always said, give me license to say cracker, 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 ever showed up, is going to rise again, all right? In the name of our humanity, in the name of who we are, in our most authentic selves, before it was ever colonized out of Black, out of brown, out of all of our identities, before colonization came. And so we are imagining that in the spirit of our revolutionary ancestors. You know what? I'm also realizing we've completely skipped over our political statement for the night that Angela was supposed to give, but I'm gonna let her.
Oh, I'm gonna get it in. Don't worry. This woman voice will be heard tonight. Thank you.
Oh, my bad, my bad. Yes, because as I'm saying it, I'm thinking about how, you know, we've been doing this revolutionary work, and the state always responds to revolutionary initiatives and drive by trying to co-opt it, by trying to dilute it, by trying to make it less than what we said, we said, we said, and we meant it when we said it. with our collective, you know, hearts and chests, all that. So we wrote a statement recently that you might have seen on social media, addressing some of that co-optation. Angela was a driving force behind delivering that truth, and she's going to deliver it to us tonight after Malcolm speaks to our vision around Juan Samalo Square. We're going to address the renaming commission, and then we'll take Q&A from folks. So for now, go ahead and give it up for our elder Malcolm Suba.
All right, good evening, comrades. Can y'all hear me?
Yes.
Okay, good, good. First, to Jitu, thank you for coming and sharing with us. And to all the people who came before me, great job. We wanted this to be a tremendous celebration of Black August and a real truth-telling session so we can get ourselves prepared to carry out our appointed duty. Basically, we all know the story of Andrew Jackson. And those of us who are conscious are really shamefaced that statue still stands. That this statue is the most photographed iconic symbol of the city of New Orleans. And it's an honor to a butcher, a slaveholder, someone who murdered our people, drowned their freedom, and who used his victory here in New Orleans to propel himself onto the national scene and became the 7th president of the United States. But in our opinion, totally unworthy, a rotten human being, somebody that's not deserving to have any kind of recognition. But one of the things that you should realize is that the Democratic Party calls itself the Jefferson Jackson Party, founded by two slaveholders, propagated by two slaveholders, and really thrust the Democratic Party as the party of the slavocracy, as the party of the vicious oppression of people of color, especially African people. And so we know that there is no real justification for maintaining Andrew Jackson. And that's why we have created the slogan, "We can't get no satisfaction till we take down Andrew Jackson." And we are committed to that purpose. But tonight we're talking about building them up. What are we going to do to replace Andrew Jackson? What are we going to do to replace Jackson Square? And that's something that we've given serious talk and consideration. And of course, we want to honor, especially during Black August, we seek to honor those who paid sacrifice to preserve our humanity, who took the revolutionary position that we are not going to be abused and exploited by you white supremacists, and we're going to stand for freedom and liberation for our people, for the right to self-determination of the Black nation. And we would be remiss if we did not search the history of Louisiana and find somebody worthy of honoring if we're going to take the central square in an old French Quarter and make it people friendly and revolutionary friendly. And as we search the history of this city growing on the hills of Avancha, we know that this city played a key role in the development of the slave trade in the United States and the enslavement of African people. And of course, we know that all of the people who came on those first ships were not slaves. They were kidnapped victims. And of course, those people who are kidnapped, what is your first instinct? To get the hell away, right? And so we always had among our people some people who would not be degraded and be turned into a slave. They bear witness to the old black spiritual, before I'll be a slave, I'll be buried in my grave. And such a person, such people were among us. And those are people that we should be perpetuating stories of their lives. And one of the most buried stories in the history of Louisiana is the story of one Malo, one Saint Malo. Saint Malo was a Maroon. And they don't talk in our history books that we were educated on. They don't talk about Maroons in the United States. They talk about Maroons in Jamaica, Maroons in Puerto Rico. We know now through the investigation of progressive historians that there was Maroonage in the United States from the Dismal Swamp in North Carolina and Virginia, all the way to eastern parts of Texas in the swampy areas. That there were always some people among our folks who said, I am not going to be a slave. I would rather live out in the swamps with the alligators than to be here with you. Such a person was one Saint Malo. Now, we don't know much about at what age he became a Maroon. But what we do know about him is once he became a Maroon, he was their main organizer. He was their leader. He taught them how to fight the enemy, how to protect themselves. And so his story really is about how he built the largest Maroon village during the whole period of enslavement. He built a village on the North Shore near Lake Bourne and Wrigley's. And he had, at its height, he had about 50 people, men and women, entire families, who were in his encampment. And he was a bold Maroon. He often came into the city of New Orleans to carry on communication, try to organize folks who were still on the plantations. And he, of course, was getting supplies. He would bring game and stuff and fish that they caught out in the swamps. And he maintained a relationship with those people who were still on the plantations. And one thing about Maroons, of course, is that even though they said that they themselves could not be a slave, they weren't going to go far away because these were their people. And they wanted to maintain relationships with their people. And so there may have been, your uncle might have been Maroon, and you could have still been on the plantation. Your auntie could still be on the plantation and you were Maroon. And you would maintain a relationship with them because you needed certain things that were flour and oil and stuff that you could not produce out in the swamps yourself. And you had to have some way of procuring it. And of course, you had to be careful because you could be turned in at any time because they were always slave catchers. Slave catchers that we now know were the beginnings of the police in the United States. Slave catchers were always out in swamps trying to get back runaways. Running away, of course, was one of the means to negotiate terms of your enslavement with your master. You could always threaten the master, if you keep treating me so damn bad, I'm going to leave you. I'm going out in the swamps and live with the Maroons. And so that brought a bit of less punishments from the master. And they were just happy if people would go away for a few days and come back. But in that sense, the Maroons played a critical role in making slavery not so bad in certain areas. Because if there were active Maroon encampments, that was an alternate that people could really think about. I don't really have to take this shit off this master. I can leave. But of course, we know the Maroons had to be the most cunning, most brave people, because you had to deal with all the conditions out in the swamps. You had to learn how to cake yourself with mud to keep mosquitoes off. You had to learn how to skin the animals. And of course, the main thing that occurred was that we had indigenous people took us in, who said, I will teach you how to live out in the swamps. And that bond that was created between the indigenous people and the Africans, Maroons, was the basis of the tributes that the Black Indian tribes still participate in today. Many of them, of course, unaware of that true history of how that dressing as Indians became such an important factor in Black New Orleans. But anyway, Juan St. Malo got out into the woods, and he was able to unite a number of Maroon forces. And he was to demonstrate through his leadership that he was somebody that could be trusted, and that if you go run away, you would join his camp. He became famous because there was an incident in which a white American stumbled upon he and a couple of his men fishing, and began to question them. Who were they? What were they doing out there fishing without any white supervision? And of course, this white man was part of a hunting trip, and he summoned his friends, and they basically said that these were runaways. But apparently, Sam Malo was able to convince them that he was no danger to them, and would be willing to go back to his master. He was from the Aaronsburg plantation down in St. Bernard Parish now. That's where he had been enslaved. And he convinced him that his master knew that he was out there, but and he had permission. So they tied up the other, but they did not tie up St. Malo. And as they were getting that tree row and heading back towards New Orleans, St. Malo untied the other Maroons and attacked the white people and killed all four of them. And that message got back to New Orleans that this Maroon named Malo, St. Malo, had slaughtered some white men. And of course, Sam Malo also put out a warning to folks that if any slave catchers came out to their camp, woe be unto you, we will handle you. And so he became infamous among the enslaved people and became somebody that was their hero, because he was not only defying being enslaved, but he was putting up an armed defense against slave catchers. And he was finally betrayed, of course, by a couple of his lieutenants who were Judas's, who sold him out for a few Spanish blooms. He was brought back to the city of New Orleans, put on trial, found guilty of insurrection and organizing and murdering these white men. And he was hung on June 19th, which of course became Juneteenth 6 years later. But he was hung right in front of St. Louis Cathedral, right in, that was in the place that was called Place des Armes at that time, right in Jackson Square. So we were thinking that, of course, if we are going to remove Andrew Jackson, what would we replace him with? And what better set of our people who really clung to their African ways and their African humanity than the Maroons and their leader, Juan St. Malo. And so we are proposing that St. Malo be given, be honored, martyred by a statue to the Maroons and him, and that we call that square St. Malo Square. And it will be a real challenge to visitors of the city to know that this city always harbored those people within bowels of the city who treasured freedom, treasured liberation. And we think that those are the qualities that we want to promote. And so St. Malo is somebody that we want to familiarize the public with, but also not even the conscious elements, because not many people know about St. Malo, and we need to do education around him. But the story of the Maroons and the integrity of our humanity is something that we need to insist we talk to our children and to visitors alike to understand that not all of us were the docile slave that was propagated by the propagandists for the Confederates and white supremacists call. And, we need to thank St. Malo for his historic role and pay tribute to that Maroon spirit. If we described ourselves as revolutionaries, we would have to say that we're Maroons because we are outliers. We are people who have not accepted the explanations and the justifications for the continued oppression and exploitation of African people. We're the ones who stand out for self-determination for the Black nation and Black Belt South. And in essence, we are outliers. So we are in great company with Maroons. And the Maroons, of course, have a noble history that we must embrace. And Black August celebrates all those freedom fighters. And it would be fitting if we do the same. I'll end there. Answer your question. Thank you.
All right, thank you for that. Thank you for that, Brother Malcolm. Especially appreciating that reminder that we are the modern day Maroons. We are the ones carrying on the tradition. One thing that was said that really resonated with me was how insecure the slaveholders felt because of the Maroons creating this kind of chink in their armor and creating like a hole in their shipet, so to speak, that is, they have to worry about losing more of their capital in the form of human bodies, in the form of our ancestors, because some of our ancestors were proud enough, strong enough, brave enough, took the risk enough to steal their bodies back for themselves, to steal themselves away from this wicked capitalist system. And that's what we do today as revolutionaries. We give people the inspiration and the encouragement that, you can see a thing, call it for what it is, and you can fight back. and we fight and win. And so to that end, we know that the state never is going to be happy about what we're doing. And they got a lot of ways that they try to silence us, that they try to quell our forces. And it's not always just with weaponry. Sometimes it's just with really tricky, manipulative, gross, grimy, nasty deception, where they will present themselves as being the truth, but there'll be a false version of us. They'll be saying something that sounds revolutionary, but it's not at all. It's reformist. It's always a diluted version of what we're talking about. So when we say Juan Samalo Square, they'll probably say something else that's a lot more soft, reactionary, that doesn't address our revolutionary spirit and what was necessary to get Andrew Jackson out of there in the first place and to get slavers out there in the first place with people like Juan Samalo. So to that end, I'm going to go ahead and pass the rest of this evening off to our sister, Angela Kinlaw. She's going to address exactly that issue of co-optation and how the city is trying to do that to our movement right now. And after that, Angela, if you want to go ahead and fill the Q&A and the call to action, it's all yours. My apologies if I got to slip out of here at 8:15, y'all, but I know y'all got it from here. And I look forward to seeing y'all on Saturday.
Okay, we got it. So look, y'all, I'm not going to take a lot of your time, but I need all of your attention. So this is what I need you to do. I need you, if you are able to stand, I want you just to stand, stretch, take a deep breath, sit back down. And when I see everybody sitting back down, I'm going to get started. I'm going to give some words, fill the Q&A, and then give you this call to action because this is critical. So I'm going to join you. Take a nice stretch. Take a deep breath. Focus your mind and heart so you can get this last piece. Because I can't have you get all this good information tonight. And then tomorrow we say we had a good time. We need application of the knowledge, okay? So once I see everybody's ready, I'm looking, I'm scrolling through. Okay, so here's the deal. I want to share with you some information because we like to be real open and public about things that are going on in the fight for Take 'Em Down NOLA. And so what I'm about to share with you has actually been shared publicly on our social media pages. But because you are here in this space, I want to acknowledge your humanity and have you hear a few things directly from us so you can help spread the word and the message, because the reality is the city is manipulative and the state lies. So I just want to be real clear about where we are with some things, because this is all researchable and you can find it for yourself. So let me just start off by acknowledging everybody who's in this session right now, because we are in the belly of the beast here in the U.S. and we are in the South. And even despite the fact that we know across the U.S. and around the world, people have looked to Black resistance to actually motivate and encourage movements around the globe. Why? Because since we are in the belly of the beast, and we know Black people have historically been oppressed, when Black people here rise up, it's a signal to people across the diaspora that shoot, you know, they got them convinced and conformed and all kinds of things in the United States because of the nature of the exploitation and oppression. And a lot of it doesn't come always from literal chains. Some of this exists in the chains of the minds. So as we transitioned out of chattel enslavement still continued in the form of wage enslavement. And the reason that they didn't need literal chains is because they knew we were physically hungry. And as long as we hungry and gotta pay bills, they don't need a chain to bring us back. We're gonna keep coming back to a job that pays low wages to take care of our families. Why? Because we're hungry and we need housing to be protected from the elements. We have children and we care about them, right? So with that being said, we've had some interesting dynamics and engagement with the city of New Orleans since we started Take 'Em Down NOLA. And one of the most recent current events that are happening right now is that the city of New Orleans has created a renaming commission. Now, this renaming commission is an interesting thing, and I'm gonna speak about that. But 5 years ago, more than 5 years ago when we started this conversation about removing the symbols to white supremacy from the landscape of New Orleans as a much necessary part of the struggle toward racial and economic justice, as an entry point into what they were saying is truth and reconciliation. You can't have reconciliation without truth, right? And so while all of this is transpiring, there were some people who didn't even want to say the words white supremacy out loud in City Hall. So now that people are comfortable talking about it, talking about race and saying a thing, and everybody still is not comfortable, we understand what our role is. And our role is not to placate, to negotiate and try to meet the needs of the rich ruling class of New Orleans, okay? So let me just share with you a few things. We are hugely excited when people finally decide that they want to see symbols to white supremacy be removed. Just recently, Helena Moreno, a city council person on the board, was so excited to be able to tout that Kamala Harris had written a letter saying we should definitely take down Jeff Davis, the Boulevard sign, and replace it, right? Kamala Harris wouldn't have touched this topic with a 10-foot pole 5.5 years ago, and we know that. But because the landscape is changing, the pressure is on because of mass uprisings, now you want to talk about the removal of this sign, but you don't want to talk about the practices and the actual systematic oppression that our people are experiencing that are in alignment with that man's name. So we say for the last 500 years, Take Them Down NOLA has continued the long history of resistance that preceded us. We know organizers, longtime revolutionary organizers like Reverend Avery Alexander, and we don't have many reverends like that today, Avery C. Alexander, who fought for progressive change, both symbolically and systemically, was put in a chokehold in 1993 by police for protesting against white supremacist David Duke, who Dillard University, a historically black university, just allowed David Duke to come a couple years ago and give a speech on that campus. And we had to raise up around that. We know at the end of the day, in 1963, Reverend Avery C. Alexander was also literally dragged, and you can find this on YouTube, the footage is there, dragged by his heels up the stairs out of the basement cafeteria of New Orleans City Hall for resisting the racist practices of segregated lunch counters and all of the other places that were segregated right here in Orleans Parish provided to black people. That was in 1963. The police chokehold was in 1993. And we know that there would be no Take Them Down NOLA without Reverend Avery C. Alexander, just like there would be no renaming commission without the work of Take Them Down NOLA. And we're not blind to that. We're also very clear that after we were publicly ignored by the city of New Orleans in terms of our demands, the people rose up and interrupted every single one of their city meetings with statement after statement after statement. It went on for hours to the point where they were so tired of the statements, embarrassed by it, and it had been taken over their commission meetings, that they finally reached out to Take Them Down NOLA to say, the vice president of the commission reached out to us to say, his name is Mark, that he wanted to meet with the leadership of Take Them Down NOLA so we could figure out a constructive way for us to contribute to the conversation. We say what we're doing already is constructive. We say that we know we are having impact or there would be no commission. We know at the end of the day that we're having impact or you wouldn't have felt comfortable putting out a petition to have the name changed in an effort to show that you had been doing something so that they could select you to be a leader on that commission. We understand all of that. You, on the other hand, believe that if you're going to have a secret private meeting with us over coffee, that that's going to temper our resistance, and it will not. We understand right now everything that we're saying has already been made public and has been shared on our pages, so this is no secret. We are also here to say that we know at the end of the day that the city and the world is rising up, literally. So for you to have a renaming commission that chooses a handful of the city signs, the city street names, when we have put out a comprehensive list and dug them up, you say we're gonna have researchers come in because you wanna validate that our research that we've been doing for years is maybe not as is validatable, making that word up, is that how dare you decide that you're going to talk about a few street names and not contend with the removal of the 10 remaining monuments that still exist? Because here's what we know. Even if you had to take some time to decide what the replacement street names would be, which takes time, and you want that time because you want to stall this process, there is no more time needed to remove the 10 monuments that could go yesterday with a crane and some wheel. We have seen the workers of the city be able to do it, and when the workers are not asked to do it by the city or the mayor, the people have taken down two of those monuments on their own. So we know it's not about cost, because we'll joyfully do it for you for free. We know it's not about will, because the people have demonstrated the will, and we know at the end of the day that the mayor of New Orleans is compromising with these white supremacists, because one of the first things that she did when she took office was have secret private meetings with the white supremacists. No, we're not hating on her. That's what she did, because the journalists revealed the minutes in the newspaper from the meetings. I'm gonna pause there and let you think about that for a second. So when the people decided to take down that bust that's in Duncan Plaza, and they try to act all discombobulated about it because the white supremacists went and found the bust and dragged it out of the river after the protesters put it in the river, you have those white supremacists' faces on video. You know who they are, and you can see the number to their truck license plate. But you'd rather scrutinize the people who were bold enough to stand up in the face of white supremacy, since you will not do that job. The people of New Orleans said that they would do it. And we refuse to allow people to be targeted by the state for doing the job that the people asked the state to do. So we're gonna keep moving. We wanna also just point out that if this commission really wanted to do something, they would push for those final monuments to be removed. They would not hesitate to advocate and support the schools that are already saying that they're changing their names, and OPSB, now New Orleans Public Schools, modified name to downplay what's happening with the exploitation in the charter schools, is to be able to say that we know this needs to happen and we're not fearful. But even if you believe that what we're talking about is not as important, here's what we do know. 63% of the city budget goes toward cops, jails, and reactive measures. They get on TV and try to criminalize Black people by talking about Black on Black crime when they don't ever talk about white on white crime. And there's more of that happening than even the Black people who've been oppressed for centuries. So if white people are committing more violence and more crime and more white on white crime than Black people who've been oppressed for centuries, then you got a head start and you're doing worse than us. How come the media doesn't talk about that? We need to also be mindful that if we say children shouldn't be running in the streets doing this and that and the other, and we're criminalizing these Black babies, then that would mean that you would invest more than 3% into children and families. That's what the budget does, and 1% into job development, unsustainable jobs. And all this is communicated in the response that we've shared publicly. The part that we wanted to make sure that you all were clear about tonight is we indicated that what this commission could do if they were serious is, again, remove immediately the 10 monuments that still remain. 7 of them are already down. And 2, they could be really mindful of our replacement criteria. So I'm gonna quickly just read this to you, very short and sweet. Take 'Em Down NOLA not only has criteria for which symbols to remove, but we also have Build 'Em Up NOLA criteria. When removing symbols to white supremacy, exploitation, and oppression, we need revolutionary criteria for replacement. Take 'Em Down NOLA uses the following criteria. 1, images that honor, uplift, and celebrate resistance to exploitation and oppression. 2, images of revolutionaries and revolutions, not just individual people, but comprehensive movements of collectives, groups of people, those people and movements that fought for liberation of oppressed people. 3, images that edify, celebrate, honor, and revere complete liberation. 4, not images that fetishize Black trauma, suffering, exploitation, or oppression, because people are quick to put up a monument of a Black person looking woe is me with a chain around their neck. That's not inspirational, motivational, or exercising our resistance in a real way. We want the kinds of symbols and monuments, as Malcolm has just described for us, as a replacement, to be able to motivate people to seek for liberation, not for compliance, not for placating with the rich ruling class, not for blending in, because even though we had a white supremacist monument, they named it Battle of Liberty. They called it liberty. Liberty for who? Those are the kind of words that they use to try to pretend like it's something that it's not, when it's not liberty for all people. And then last but not least, we ask people, and the commission could be doing this, make those connections between symbols and systems. Talk about how they are connected. Make sure that our people understand what is transpiring. But we know that the commission's not going to do that. We already know what their purpose and their function is. And so with that being said, we have a responsibility to speak truth to power, even when it's uncomfortable, and even when the people act like we're the ones who are crazy, we're the ones who are cutting up, we're the ones who are we don't know. We're very clear. But the reason we look like we're out here wilding out is because we don't operate within the boundaries of the way in which this system is set up to comply with exploitation and oppression. So yeah, we look different out here, but that's okay. So I'm gonna say this last piece for the people who missed the forum that the New Orleans Workers Group just put on. One of the things that I had a chance to share in that environment was that there was grassroots organizing in Alabama during the Great Depression. And our school textbooks don't show us Black people during the Great Depression rising up and fighting back. You always see images of white people looking like they're holding on by a string. And many of those working class white people had to make a choice about how they were going to fight back as well. But Black resistance was in full effect. And in Alabama, a very repressive, oppressive place to be in the South, there were Black people who were unafraid to actually, even though it's criminalized to call themselves communists, they understood that they were communists. And even if they considered themselves to be Christian when they stepped into that communist role boldly, they also were not afraid to be armed up and prepared for whatever came their way. The reason that I want to call those Black revolutionaries out is because they were the ones who were able to put the fire behind the Scottsboro case. It wasn't the NAACP. The NAACP was in alignment with the rich ruling class. They were more focused on Black business, the Black elite, and the Black middle class. That's what this commission is in alignment with. And if we don't make that connection, that their goal is to temper us, temper our resistance, and let everybody else feel like there's progress as they sit under the veil of illusions, we have a responsibility to clear that up, make that real plain for people, and not water that down. So that's all I'm gonna say about that part. I'm gonna pause right now and ask people, in the context of this forum tonight, if you have questions, you can drop them in the chat box, or if you have a wondering that you would like one of the people who spoke tonight to answer or to respond to, this is the time to do that before we round out with the call to action. Just a couple of announcements before we close out. So you can drop your questions in the chat box, or if there's somebody who has a pointed question that you would like to ask, you can take yourself off mute and we will go there. We'll take three people off mute and the rest we ask you to drop into the chat box and we'll see if we have time to answer any questions. Anybody with a pressing question? I'm looking to see if the little emoji hand is up, or if you want to take yourself off mute, this would be a great time to ask your question. Either Brother Jitu, Brother Malcolm, or myself, for anyone else. Anyone else have a question? Okay, y'all acting like y'all real clear. Okay, that's good. All right, so very quickly, Brother Jitu, we do have a question for you, and we'll email this out afterwards. Brother Jitu, can you name the title of the book that you had suggested people read again?
Yes, two of the books are written by George Jackson. The first one's a compilation of letters, exchange of letters with his family and with Angela and a few other people. And that's called Prison George Jackson, Solidarity Brother, Prison Letters. And the other book was more of a strategic book that dealt with ways to fight, and that's Blood in My Eye. The other book is The Melancholy History of Solidarity Prison. There are quite a few others, but I just named a few. That one gives you a history of resistance inside of California prisons, primarily in Soledad Prison and in San Quentin Folsom. So that gives you kind of a backdrop of some of the stuff that I shared. I also want to quickly mention that there were several sisters who I was negligent in not mentioning that's been part of the movement. One is Nihanda Abionda, who was in exile along with Sasha Shakur, who just recently transitioned. Two other sisters, Samaya, who we call Sister Red, who was part of the firefight in 1969 at the Black Panthers headquarters on 41st and Central. And then another sister is part of the movement. She's part of the Black Liberation Army, and that was Sophia Bukhari.
Thank you for that. Thank you for that. Okay. Sam has a question here. How can we continue to pressure the BS Commission to expand its definition beyond Confederates and removing Paul, foot dragging? I don't know what that says. I'm sorry. Sam, you want to just come on and ask the question? I want to make sure I'm reading it correctly.
Yeah, I think one of the issues that kept being brought up in a lot of the comments over the last couple of meetings is about the conflict of interest with Paul, who seems to be not, I mean, I've been following the meetings and kind of tracking which commissioners are where, because I think some of them are willing to move beyond Confederates to bring down more of the symbols. He seems to be a big one, and I know there's a conflict of interest there. So I'm wondering, you know, what kind of pressure we can put to remove him, and then also expand the definition, because I've contacted almost every commissioner and have been trying to have conversations about that, just to bring out the gap between the obvious language and the ordinance that created the commission, to narrow the scope and to delimit the mission, you know, to undercut the real broader movement that you guys have been working on for a long time. So you just speak to that kind of strategically, because I mean, I'm going to continue to do that. So I'm just curious what the strategy there might be.
Yeah, I think there's a few things. One of which is to continue doing that. Two is that every single time they have one of these meetings, they're hoping that people will kind of fizzle out and not speak about it. One of the reasons that they felt pressed to even take a step is because there have been so many voices. When it's one or two people, they don't have to do anything. But one of the reasons that we ask people to constantly be in these streets is because people are always under the impression that it's going to be legislation, or it's going to be some new policy or some new thing that's going to be put on paper that's going to make them move. What has to happen is there has to continually be pressure. People have to constantly be in their faces about it. They have to hear about it all the time until they get tired of it. People have to be in these streets. And then sometimes the people decide to stop talking about them and just take them down. People have to make decisions about what they're going to do, when and where, but the people are rising. And if it is a belief that these monuments need to be removed, people will do everything within their power to ensure that can happen. As grassroots organizers, we've been putting forth consistent work behind us for the last 5 years. And the reason we've been doing so is it's not simply just about the removal of the monuments, it's about the elevation of consciousness of the people. Because even if the monuments were moved tomorrow, you blink your eyes for too long, they'll put it right back up. And we saw that with that same old raggedy so-called Battle of Liberty monument that was a white supremacist monument that had the words white supremacy on the placard. And how many years do people skip past that and pretend like that was normal? So everywhere we go, we have a responsibility to elevate consciousness around it. And not only in the spaces where other people are already talking about this and like-minded. You have to insert this into the conversation in the places where sometimes it's uncomfortable. Because us sitting around talking to each other about it only goes so far. We have to stir it up and turn it up sometimes. And it's okay. People really think that revolutionaries, we just out here wilding out, we just upset and mad all the time. I'm a very joyful person who skips through the park and blows bubbles. But when it comes to exploitation and oppression, can't have it. And at some point in time, we have to open our mouths and line up our actions with our words, period. Antoinette is asking, Brother Jitu, can you speak more deeply about the role of conflict resolution in our revolutionary movement and not utilizing the state? You had mentioned that earlier. Can you just say another piece about that? Yes. And some more information will be shared with people after about that as well.
Right. As I indicated, I shared some information with Angela. I have another piece that gives a detailed account of how we address that conflict within our circles. We don't depend on the state for anything. If you decide to be part of this movement, you have to understand that, and historically we've seen this, whenever there's a problem among us, and I'm just talking about on a basic level, among family members, they'll have a loved one that's wilding out or doing something that's kind of productive to themselves or hurting themselves or someone else, and they'll call we've been conditioned to call the state to address our personal issues. And what do they, 9 times out of 10, when they come, they end up killing the person, killing our loved one. So on an organizational level, we let those that have been victimized understand that if there's a problem, we're gonna address that problem among ourselves. So that's one of the things we did with the tribunal back in 2012. But also on an organizational level, we've seen that the state would pit one group against the other and in order to undermine the work they were doing. And we spend so much time fighting among ourselves that we really don't look at who our real enemy is and what they're doing to us. And so there was an incident that happened back in 2015, in the August of 2015, August 8th to be exact, where this group in Georgia, Atlanta, Georgia, New African Black Panther Party, there was a conflict between them and an elder who was one of the New York 21, Daruba Ben-Wahad, who would spend 19 years in prison, allegedly for killing a pig. And there was ideological conflict between them that led to Daruba being assaulted. And so that had national implications. And so what we did was we got with people that were respected around the country who've been a part of the movement to just talk about it, how to deal with this. And that's where the code of conduct came up, where people embraced that on a local level and a family level and an organizational level and discussed ways how we can address our particular issues so that we can continue to move forward and deal with our real enemies. So it's a lot more complex than that. Like I say, I've given the sisters some of the documentation that we've used or that we've developed over a period of time. And the other thing is that we don't want to just ostracize someone without using some type of restorative justice to correct that problem.
Excellent. Brother Jitu, right on time. Ashe. Okay. So it looks like these questions have each been addressed. Want to make sure we don't skip over anybody or ignore anybody. Okay. We're going to share with you this final quick piece in terms of the call to action. We want to let you know that there are a number of actions coming up. Take 'em Down NOLA has one on Saturday. And we really want to highlight the importance of encouraging people to participate in these actions or these demonstrations, because it's one thing to see them on TV happen. It's another thing to actually be in the streets and begin the process of actually building solidarity with the people who are out fighting. And so why is being in the streets so important? Why does that even matter? You know, people say, I'm tired of marching and I don't do nothing. Well, let me tell you this. People have been complaining since January 2017, really since the November before, about this current president. And we hear all the complaints, but we feel like you're not serious unless you've been in these streets. Because when you look at the people of PR, Puerto Rico, they looked at their governor and said, you're not serving us. So they got into the streets and they raised the roof until he was ousted. They did that. And this man has not felt half of what he should have during his time in office. It took a mass uprising for Black lives for people then to say, well, we can go up to the White House, let's focus on him. He's been a problem, but legislation does not precede the uprisings. The uprisings precede the legislative change. They precede the people who try to squeal their way into an office and act like they're for the people. It precedes that. Every progressive change we have ever had historically has been because of resistance. People saying no more in an action-oriented way. And even though people will make it seem like revolutionaries are violent, it's not us who's violent. It's us who's fighting in the name of self-determination for our liberation. And because they don't want us to be liberated, they push back. You have seen with your own eyes the most peaceful protest that could ever be. And here come the state, armed up, because the mere fact that you're on these streets is a threat. People were literally in community playing violins in the middle of the street as a sign of resistance. And what happened? The police came and swooped them up. Now, what are they doing playing those violins? They are saying we're standing in solidarity with Black lives. So it don't matter how peaceful we are. We have to rise up at some point in time and make it real plain that it's a problem. Because if it's not a problem to us, it's not going to be a problem to them. They would joyfully have kept us on that sugar plantation. We would not be on a Zoom call tonight. So let me just show you this screen. Just a few quick things. We're talking about fighting for Black lives while we yet live. We know people like to get riled up when they hear about Black lives being slaughtered in the streets, police sanctioned or state sanctioned terror. We're saying this whole system is effed up. I know somebody's child is in the room, so let me be mindful. And so with that being said, this whole system needs an overhaul and change. And we're not just fighting for Black lives so we can respond when we see blood on the concrete, blood been on the concrete. We're saying while we yet live, that's the kind of fight we need to prevent us from being slaughtered in the streets. So one of the ways people can demonstrate some resistance is by actually coming out to Gordon Plaza, which is gonna be next Wednesday, September 9th at 6 p.m. If you don't have background information on this story, you are more than welcome to go to the New Orleans People's Assembly Facebook page. The residents participated in a forum last night. You can get caught up in about an hour if you watch that forum to understand that we have an all-Black working class neighborhood of families who purchased homes in the name of affordable housing, and the city of New Orleans built their home on a toxic landfill. That neighborhood, the Desire neighborhood, is considered the second highest cancer-causing neighborhood in the state of Louisiana. So we talk about Cancer Alley, we talk about Death Alley, and people out here pretending like New Orleans is not a part of Death Alley. New Orleans has been a part of Death Alley. But because this is a tourist city, we try to put that behind us and get excited about Jazz Fest, Essence Fest, and everything else. But we got whole Black lives out here that need saving while we yet live. Join us for that action. The next one is just a screen that shows you that, you know, if you can't come out, you can't join us for an action, you're quarantining, you're making the choices that you need to make for yourselves, we understand it. You from your home can contact the mayor and communicate the need for a fully funded relocation, because all of the necessary hoops that needed to be jumped by any grassroots organizer from Gordon Plaza or beyond have already been done. All the red tape is cleared now. The only thing we need is for Mayor LaToya Cantrell, the first Black woman mayor, Democrat, by the way, to do what she said she would do when she was on the campaign trail. She said she would support this relocation, and she has not moved on it yet. But she also has not moved on a number of things she said she would do for Black people when she was running for office. Let it be known. On Saturday, Take 'Em Down NOLA will be making the connection between symbols and systems. I don't know how much more evidence people need. I don't know how many more studies and reports people need about the way in which Black people are suffering in this country. And so while Black people are rising up, we need more people to rise up. We need everybody to rise up. Because when Black people are liberated, everybody else has a chance at that point. And we really want to see this happen for each and every Black life. Not just Black men. We want Black women to be acknowledged when we're being gunned down by the police. And that happens too. Breonna Taylor's the police still haven't been arrested. We expect that the LGBTQ community members who are gunned down by police, they Black too. Black trans lives matter. They Black too. So if we say each and every, then we can't be riled up about one Black life gunned down and silent on the other. So we're moving on. That's Saturday, 6 p.m., Lafayette Square, September 5th, about to go hard. And then we ask you to continue to support the sanitation workers, the hoppers, who are on strike, working for Metro. A Black business owner, by the way, Black elite, Black rich ruling class member, because he got money. He got that money. And he is exploiting the labor of his workers, blaming it on the city. That's what they do. They like to point fingers when you could easily reduce your profits and pay these people. We also want to remind people that New Orleans has twice the eviction rate as the entire United States of America. So whatever the eviction rate ever is for the USA, New Orleans is twice that. And it does not count for everybody who's been evicted since quarantine, since COVID-19. It does not speak to the people who were already unhoused. It does not speak to the people who get kicked out of their homes not through eviction court, but because they have a shady landlord who just puts them out in the street, just changes the locks, couches out on the street. And you cannot pass through New Orleans in a Black neighborhood and go five blocks and not see stuff on the sidewalk. So when we say we're fighting for Black lives while they yet live, we know that when Black people get any progress, it only opens up the door of possibility and progress and forward movement for everybody else. And we know that because the state don't care about poor white people either. The poor white people just don't always know that. They following these racist practices because they feel like, oh, your foot is on the neck of a Black person. My progress at the expense of yours. And at some point in time, we have to stop with the division and turn all of our attention to the source of all of our problems, which is the members of the rich ruling class, all the bosses and owners that exploit all of our labor. So when I think about those who were on participating in the bus boycott for social change, no more segregation, I want to sit in the bus, I want my dignity, I want to sit anywhere I want on the bus. But a part of the story they don't tell you is even when we get to sit wherever we want on the bus, what difference does it make if we all go into the same low wage paying job? So at some point in time, we as a people have to stop waiting for permission from people in the state, the city council, the commission, this and that. Stop waiting on an election for change and start pushing for systemic fundamental change. So somebody else's child don't have to be talking about this same topic 40 years from now. All right, my people, that brings us to the close of tonight. I'm gonna ask Antoinette if you can please take yourself off mute and give us a closing affirmation. And we're gonna hit click.
Gratitude to you all for sharing space and time with us tonight, especially to the speakers tonight, the artists. We know when we're talking about build them up, we are not only building a foundation from the historical context of resistance, but we're asking artists to lead the way, right? The imagination is necessary to form a new world we have not yet seen, right? We out here fighting, y'all. We out here fighting. We're putting our skin in the game. We got our sweat on these streets, right? And we're not doing it in vain. We know that there were some of you who wouldn't even be in this space right now if folks weren't on the street. Those of us who were on the street wouldn't be in this space right now if it wasn't for revolutionary elders who led the way, right? We're all building on top of the legacy of each other, right? We're not alone in this, never alone in this. That's the lie of capitalism, y'all. It tells us, you know what, if you as an individual pull up your bootstrap, you know, you make your way alone in this world, you know, you can do it, right? As they continuously land blows on our access to liberation, our access to health, you know, as they try to feed us this lie that we are not each other's keepers. But we know, our lived experiences tells us so. We know we're not traveling this world alone. There can be no point in time where, if I was sick, I can heal myself, right? If I needed an education that I could teach myself, that I needed healing hands that I could do that myself. We must forge together, forge ahead together. So before we leave this digital space, I want us to ground ourselves in that collectivity, right? Reach through space and time to our beloved revolutionary sister, Assata Shakur, who again gave us a blueprint on how to navigate these tumultuous times, how to make a way out of no way, which is always together. So I'm gonna ask that you put your microphone on mute, but please don't be silent and repeat after me when I say, it is our duty to fight for our freedom. It is our duty to win. We must love and protect each other. We have nothing to lose but our chains. It is our duty to fight for our freedom. It is our duty to win. We must love and protect each other. We have nothing to lose but our chains. It is our duty to fight for our freedom. It is our duty to win. We must love and protect each other. We have nothing to lose but our chains. We have nothing to lose but our chains. We have nothing to lose but our goddamn chains. Ashe, ashe.
Ashe, Ashe. Yes. Yes. Take yourselves off mute. Let's say goodnight.
Thank you.
Thank you, Nana Anoa.
Good night. Good night. We jumping off? Comrade. Good job, y'all. Good job, famo. I'm gonna shut it down so I could save this recording. Okay. And I could come to the next joint. All right, y'all.
Okay. Good night.